Mic check, mic check.
Okay, we're ready. Hey guys, it's Tony, Chelsea, and Matt Granger live.
Hello.
All the way from Australia.
Yeah, especially just for today.
Today we're looking at travel photos, and we're not sponsored by anybody in particular. So we'll probably send you over to Matt's site and to our site.
Yeah.
Matt's got an awesome YouTube channel that you can check out, and you can follow him on a variety of social media, which he says he's not that great at.
I'm a little lazy, that's true.
If you are watching live and you want to send your photo in for us to review, go to, that is not the right URL. Do not go there.
I'm sorry.
Go to northrop.photo/submit, and there'll be a form there, and you can submit it. Submit one photo per person, and we'll take a look at it during the course of the live show. We're going to be looking at a lot of photos today because we don't have sponsors. We're not going to be doing news or chit-chat or anything.
Okay. No chit-chat.
That's my favorite.
Just keep that in mind.
That's my favorite segment.
There are two ways you can communicate with us, and we'd love for you to send Matt some questions. If you're watching
carrier
live.
Carrier pigeon.
Carrier pigeon? No.
They attract the hawks. We've established that.
Yeah. You can write a comment, and our screener, Siobhan, out in Philly, will read it and then ask us, and we can respond to you in real time. Or if you're on Twitter, use the hashtag TCLive, and our producer, Justin, can throw it on the screen if Justin finds you entertaining. But Justin's kind of a curmudgeon. Maybe Justin, once he gets through his beer, he'll...
I think he's playing video games.
Yeah, he's busy.
He's doing his taxes.
Yeah, video games.
He's doing his taxes.
Okay, so while you guys send your photos into northrop.photo/submit...
Wait, they can ask Matt questions, too.
Yeah, so Siobhan, if somebody asks a reasonable question, feel free to jump in. But in the meantime, Matt, I'll just ask you about your gear, because people love gear. What do you travel with? Like, where was the last destination? You went to Bhutan, right?
Yeah, that was a long one, though. So Thailand, Bhutan, Mongolia, Seoul, back to Sydney. So that was 6 weeks.
Six weeks at a time. And what kind of gear do you travel with?
That one, I had two systems. I had the D810 and pretty much only the 70-200, because I kind of broke another 24-70. So I sent that home after Bhutan. I think that'd be four.
The Nikons. I broke one too.
Yeah.
Maybe they're just not that durable.
Must be.
How have you broken them?
I broke two in half.
Wow.
And another two.
You have manly hands.
Well, yeah, I just get so angry. No, this one, a porter at a hotel dropped the bag and it landed right on top, unfortunately. Mm. It's not broken, just it's really stiff, so it'll need something. And it always ends up being a barrel replacement at the end of the day anyway.
Yeah.
So I really only use the D810 for festivals, where I had my longest lens is a 70-200 with a 1.7. So pretty much everything on that camera was at 340 for the whole trip. And then I had the A7R II with the two Bardas lenses and the 16-35. And I mostly use a 16-35, actually.
The Sony 16-35?
Yeah. Which would be nice if it was good quality, but it's very versatile. It's okay, but it's not like the brilliant lens.
I feel the same way. I've been using the Canon 16-35 on the Metabones adapter with the A7R II because...
How's
the focus? We're going to be doing a full test, but it's okay. Yeah. It focuses, it's not like it focuses on a Canon body.
It's funny, isn't it? If you're going out thinking, okay, today's manual focus, it's no problem. Take the 2 or 3 seconds. But when you are trying to and it's just like a second slower than it should be, it's so frustrating.
I pretty much, with that camera, I pretty much just end up manually focusing because sometimes the autofocus will work great, but you can't have it be inconsistent.
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't take that long to manually focus, but it takes a long time if you try to autofocus a couple of times and it fails, and then you're like, shit, I just have to manually focus at this point.
Yeah.
So yeah, I just start by manually focusing. Siobhan, has anything come in? I'll start loading some pictures in.
Yes. Kyle Wolf wants to know, Matt, what is your best suggestion for photographing children when you're traveling as a male photographer without seeming creepy?
Okay. That's a good question.
Hi, Kyle. I think it varies by country, and to be honest, and myself, I don't assume that parents are going to be funny about it. Maybe not being a parent, I'm not sensitive to it. I know in Australia, America, and the UK, people seem to be a bit more cautious about it. But, when I'm out with my friend's kid, if someone came to take a photo, I wouldn't just assume they're a predator. I would just think they think it's a cute kid and they want to take a photo. So I have the same approach. If the parent's right there, then I'll smile and be friendly about it, and is it okay if I take a photo of your son or daughter, cute outfit, something like that. In like places like Bhutan and Mongolia, most people just love to have their photo taken, so it's nothing, it's no big deal. I don't really get turned down for taking photos of kids any more than adults. And yeah. Kids, especially in those kind of countries, kids see a camera and they just run for you. Mm-hmm. They want their photo taken. So
Tony scared some children.
Yeah,
that's
well,
why
I'm
my parents are concerned.
Well, that's why I needed the advice.
Well, I found this has been my experience. Even as a woman, people can get a little freaked out with me. And I do the sneaky thing where I act like I'm looking
why.
At something else.
That's why they find that you're creepy.
No, that's when they don't expect it. And then I'm more wide angle than they would think. And then that's when I can kind of just be like, oh, that. But I'm
so
really
all your
focusing.
Child photos are like a kid in their ethnic costume in the front and then Tony at the background at the bar or something.
Yeah, pretty much. I have to be a little sneaky about it.
I think the same with street photography. If you go to take a photo, notice somebody's looking and you're worried they're not happy, and then you sneak away, of course that's going to look dodgy, especially with kids. But if you make eye contact with the parents, smile, take a photo, have a chat with them, you know, I don't approach travel photography like a ninja like some people. I would much rather go and chat to the family and, you know, where am I from and what are they doing and what's their name and then...
So just being really open about
it. Yeah.
Maybe wear a shirt that says I'm not a creep.
That would do it, I'm
sure.
Yeah, yeah. So
or give out free candy.
I work for NASA.
Free candy.
Yeah.
Or tell the kids, I'll give you free candy. Come here.
Yeah, do you like kittens?
You're welcome, Kyle.
I will say I got an email just this past week from somebody who said they'd basically given up photography because they were so concerned that people were going to think that they were a creep.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, you just have to get over that. That's in your head.
Exactly.
And yeah, some small portion of people, maybe it's 5%, maybe it's 10%, but it's a small portion. Mm-hmm. They will think that you're a creep, but that's on them.
Yeah.
That is their feeling, and you can't let that change you. And if they do think you're a creep, like the worst thing that can happen is they'll come up and they'll say, hey, what are you doing here?
Yeah.
But it's not going to land you in jail. It's not
going to
get you beaten up.
Why has he got such a guilty conscience?
No, but
some people are just very concerned about other people's feelings.
Yeah, totally agree. I had the same conversation at the photo walk yesterday that actually when I was starting out doing street stuff, I was always concerned that older women wouldn't be comfortable having their photo taken, whatever. Mm. That was my thing. So whenever I would find someone that I thought wouldn't like to have their photo taken, I forced myself to go and ask them, could I take their photo? And yeah, it's just bullshit. It's in your head. It's not. I find it's like 1 in 10 might say no, and it doesn't matter if they're young or old or men or women.
Does the gear make a difference to you? Do you feel like a bigger DSLR?
I think that's in people's head too.
Because
people who are into photography will, like the guy who you saw at the show, will focus on the camera. And so, you know, people who aren't, they might think you're a professional and that's something to worry about, or they might think you're a professional, so that makes you legit. So, you know, if you're using a little, you know, camera phone trying to pretend to shoot someone, that's probably going to raise alarms. Yeah, shoot from the hip.
Matt alluded to a funny story yesterday. We were at Photo Expo Plus, actually, it was Friday. And there were a lot of people who wanted to come up and say hi, and they'd read the book or whatever. But there was this one guy who came up to Chelsea and, like, never made eye contact because he never broke contact with her Canon 5DSR. That was the celebrity.
It's a beautiful
and
camera.
He was taking pictures of her camera and talking to her about the camera, and he had it, like, hold her up.
He told me, he said, hold it here, here. Now smile. And I'd be like, nope, hold it here.
Had he framed you out like the camera was obliterating you?
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know. But he had some specific photo in mind.
Okay.
Yeah, he was really into that camera.
Yep. Did not notice the pretty girl. Just noticed the big old Canon.
He was like, you're a monster. Cover your face with this camera. What else, Siobhan?
Well, let's see.
What the hell?
Matt. Oh. You were recently in Edinburgh with Dom Bauer. How did you like the city?
That was nice. I was only there for, I don't know, maybe 4 or 5 days, shooting, workshop, meeting up with Dom as well. He's such an enthusiastic guy. You know, he loves that city so much. He drove me around for half a day, and it was just like the vlog he put up, actually. And I mean this respectfully, he didn't stop talking. Everything we passed, he told me the history of this and what this part of town means to him and his family. It was, really nice. It's a lovely city. I think I probably didn't go in a typical time because it was right during the Fringe Festival, or it was starting that weekend.
What is the Fringe Festival?
It's like the biggest alternative arts and comedy festival of Europe,
yeah.
I think. It was completely packed out. I'm sure that's not typical, but it's basically my benchmark for a city is if you can walk it, and see lots of interesting stuff, and it you can, same as New York or San Fran.
We liked it. It's
Edinburgh is gorgeous, but we did the usual thing where we show up with absolutely no preparation and just try to find a place to park and then wander around.
Nice.
Crazy place to drive, though. Let's take a look at a couple of pictures and then we'll come back with some more questions and comments. So our theme today is travel photography. Somebody just sent this in. And I think the graffiti itself is gorgeous, but it's almost falling into that category where it's a piece of an art based on a piece of art. Like, what about the picture is there besides the cool graffiti?
So for me, there's the scale. I'm seeing that there's this massive piece of art on a somewhat dilapidated building. Mm-hmm. So that's interesting to me. I could see.
Yeah, I think you're onto something about the scale, because there is a person down here. So a person could provide a sense of scale. She's kind of in an awkward position. It might be good to wait for a person to appear in the frame to provide some extra scale. I don't know. What do you think, Matt?
This is really familiar. I don't know if somebody entered this into one of my competitions previously. I think what they're going for, and it's something you get a lot when you're traveling, is that sense of either the old and the new are blending together. Like when you're looking at a city for the first time, you see all the rundown buildings and the new shiny ones.
Like these maybe buildings in the background.
Well, I was actually thinking maybe they're going for the little bit of nature and then the gritty city and then the, you know.
Yeah, I guess I feel like the tree didn't feel deliberate to me.
Yeah, the thing you said, I'm often conflicted about just shooting someone else's artwork. Like,
yeah, I have to feel like I'm adding something to it, like I'm making it my own. This feels like a firework.
Yep.
I think that was the only two pictures. Okay, well, import some more pictures.
Slow down, guys. There's only three of us.
I'm sure it's just that Siobhan is in the process of screening stuff. She's working on stuff. And Siobhan, have you screened more than two pictures?
Yeah, I sent a bunch through.
Oh, no. I wonder if our system has screwed up again. Because I got
isn't
those
that just life?
Two pictures, and I haven't had anything since. So, crap. Maybe somebody can ask Matt for a picture, and I'll figure this out.
I got excited by really small things. So you kind of hear about the big cameras coming out, and we saw them. And there was the Pentax medium format. Leica had a medium format camera. Those were interesting. But then there were these really cool Bluetooth LED lights, flashes for your phone and stuff.
Oh, what do you mean? So to use as a flash for photos or for video?
For video.
Okay.
And for a flash for photos. And I thought that was interesting. They also had a little LED light strobe that went underwater that I was very excited about because I like underwater photography, but the strobes are expensive. So it was a cheaper alternative. There's some pretty cool gadgets there. How about you?
Nice. I always get kind of excited and kind of overwhelmed at shows. Like you walk around for a while and it's like, yeah, it's all kind of cool, but I'm also kind of ready to go.
Yeah.
There wasn't that much, I thought, for, you know, compared to some other shows, big announcements. Maybe it's because the rumor sites are so good. You know what's coming a couple of weeks out anyway. I should have had an answer ready when I asked you that question.
Did you see the giant ring light?
No. Where was that?
I don't even know who
it was.
Made it.
Chimera.
Okay. Nope.
It was nice. So it was like four strobes in almost like a softbox, but a ring.
Okay.
And it made beautiful light, and they let you, you know, plug it into your hot shoe and try it out. That was
This is a picture that I took with it. It was nice because they had a setup where you could actually hook your camera into it, and they told you your camera settings so you could actually try it out. It was very expensive, but I definitely wanted it. just the kind of diffuser and ring light structure itself was, I think, $3,000. But then you would need to add four monoblocks to it. Mm. So, you know, you'd be looking at like 6K, and it was kind of a lot of work to set up.
I don't think I would invest in that, but it was, you know, you could turn off one strobe, and you could have like the clam shell lighting and side lighting, and it was
interesting. How big is it? Like 4 foot, 6 foot?
Yeah, it was probably six foot diameter on the outside.
Yeah, wow. Actually, that was something nice at the show. There was a fair few stands doing that where you could, you know, they're inviting you to test out their lens on your camera and compare it to other ones.
Yeah.
And then, was it Canon and Nikon both wouldn't let me put cards in anything, though, this year.
Really?
Yeah. Did you try on the stand?
No, I didn't.
Nikon actually said they have a policy now that putting your card in case it were to damage your card, they don't want lawsuits. so you can't test anything on the
that
show.
That doesn't sound.
That seems fake,
sounded like
right?
a blow-up.
That sounds
yeah.
like BS.
How many of their like are their cameras really destroying people's cards? Is that a concern?
Good point. No, that was I think after. They said it was pre-production. I'm like, but it's already shipping. And they said, yeah, but also we don't allow people anymore. So, yeah. Okay, so.
Oh, what was the Zhang Yi? Is that the name of the brand? What was that lens that we tried out?
They had the 135 f1.4, which is, it's like the fastest ever portrait lens. And I have a couple of samples. Oh yeah, this is with the aperture shut down to f22 or something, and then that was at f1.4, just to give you a sense for just how much background blur there was. But yeah, it was just crazy background blur. But
it was heavy though. That is something you'd want to
try. Yeah, the front element was like this or something, and yeah, it was very heavy and manual focus only.
Yeah, of course.
So with a Sony, I feel like with the focus peaking, I had success with my few shots, but. With a DSLR, like, forget it. I would never try to focus that thing. Just
yeah. Well, not you just human. Need the punching in, right? To be able to go into the eyes. Even at 135, you're going to be so far back, you know. Yeah. I guess it depends how tight a shot you're going for.
Yeah, maybe if you're not doing headshots. We do a lot of headshots and such.
You know what else was good at PhotoPlus? I had a chili cheese dog.
Chili beans.
And I got to eat it next to a dumpster. Like you do. You would have loved it. If you were there, you would have loved it. I had a pretzel bun.
That's awesome.
Thank you. All right.
Is that maybe why you're not feeling well today?
That's possible.
Yeah. Well, we'll take a look at a couple of pictures. Do you know where this is, Matt? I know you're
looks
much more
like
familiar
Thailand.
With
Thailand.
Thailand. Yeah.
And it looks like a like one of those shows set up for tourists. You have dinner and then they put the show on.
Yeah.
Yeah, so probably on a stage, spotlight. One spotlight, maybe two.
Have you ever seen someone on an elephant look more bored?
Well, that's weird. How far forward is that woman on the right? She looks quite out of focus there with the green dress and the blue conical thing.
Yeah, so they're at 400 millimeters in f2.8, so that means they're using a huge lens, one of these like 8-pound lenses. And they just didn't have enough depth of field. Mm. I think some post-processing here could have helped, like raising the shadows. We wouldn't be able to get anything out of the shadows.
I love the contrast, the bright colors on the black background.
Yeah.
They could actually be just a great shot in on the elephant's eyes up, just on that guy, because he's evenly lit, whereas the people down the bottom are all kind of out.
Oh, you're saying just kind of like crop it in?
Yeah. It doesn't quite work. It'd be better, obviously, if you could get the elephant's nose in there as well. But, you know, he's so striking, and then you see the rest is all kind of a bit wishy-washy. But it's hard in that situation. You can give all the critique you want, but you weren't there, and probably 400 mil, he was probably in between tables, and you couldn't do anything with the lighting.
Yeah, sometimes people get the best shot they could in that situation, and it's easy for us to stand back and be like, oh, you should have used a 1,200 millimeter lens and zoomed
6
in
foot
on
to the left.
Size.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So this looks like Rocky Mountains to me.
It's a bit flat to me. I think they could have waited for better light, in theory.
Yeah.
Again, I don't know their personal story.
I actually really like the dehaze tool in Lightroom. Do you use Lightroom, Matt?
I do, but I have not played with dehaze.
It's a pretty new thing
right
in CC.
See that?
Ooh.
Yeah, it's pretty smart in just kind of adding some contrast back. And so I think that helps, but... You're right, there's no kind of detail or texture in the sky. There's no focal point in the foreground, but it is a nice shot. You know, if you have like a V of geese flying through or, you know.
A man in red swim trunks jumping.
It's quite specific, isn't it?
Yeah.
How tall would he be?
6'2".
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Or even a bird flying or in the water or, something in one of those open spaces would probably balance it nicely.
Yeah, just plus one thing.
Plus one.
Okay, and so another kind of snow shot. This is, Chelsea, you're the color temperature expert. Is this too warm for a wintry shot?
It seems warm.
So you might pull it back a little bit.
I'm a color expert now. You see that? Just got promoted.
You got,
what?
And like maybe we take the highlights and make them cooler.
You guys are so clever.
Yeah, I think it's a good shot.
That would go there.
You know what? The name of the file is Falls. And I just noticed that there are waterfalls here.
Ah.
So if that's really your focal point, we didn't discover it initially.
True.
Because it kind of blends in with the snow. There's not a lot of contrast there. It's a small portion of the picture. So you might rethink the composition.
What about this?
Yeah.
Space. Right? There's nothing really happening there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Maybe they just needed to, I agree with what you said, focus on the falls a little more.
Nice.
This is lovely.
Yeah. Beautiful mood in this shot. I love the fog there.
I would crop it.
Go for it.
You guys are monsters.
Matt, you got your own mouse and keyboard there, so jump in.
So can we fight over the crop?
Oh, yeah. Wait. We could. We'd love a good fight. Come on. I just want to make that a bigger part of the picture because this is my favorite part of the picture.
Yeah.
Oh, we have a touch screen. I forget about that.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. And now that you've done that, I might have even zoomed in a little bit further. But
oh, the crop.
Yeah, the before and after.
Before and after.
The crop looks. This is a great shot, though. I think it's just a beautiful scene, and you got the lighting really nice. And that's the difference between kind of a boring shot and a good landscape shot. So I'll give that a pick.
Pick.
Oh, I love the color in that shot.
Okay.
You can't do this to me.
Okay.
Yeah, that I think when you get a shot like that, that can be, oh, it can still be luck, but it's the difference of, you know, getting out of the tour bus for 10 minutes or being able to wait around for an hour or two until the light gets just right.
Yeah.
Yeah. One of the things with landscape and travel photography in general is people, they think they can just visit Morocco for 3 days and get the postcard shot. But the guy who took that postcard shot probably lives there.
Yeah.
The best landscape photographers live at that spot because they visit it every day, not even for a year, but for decades. And then they take the very best moment from that entire 10-year period. Like Ansel Adams did landscape photography, but he would go to places for months at a time, and then he would visit it year after year after year, during different seasons, and just like waiting for that one moment when the clouds come in and the moon is visible, and you just don't luck into that very often. So maybe this person just stepped off a tour bus and got this beautiful scene. That happens, but it's real rare.
Yeah.
You hear him?
Mm-hmm.
He's pro.
Beautiful shot. I'll let you guys take a shot at it. I just want to mention, you get this kind of starburst effect when you use a high f-stop number. They're at f16, so that's why they get that kind of cool effect.
I like that they just went silhouette with it.
I like everything except for the green hue on the light.
Well, we can change that. Ready? Maybe not. I lied to you. Oh, there we go. There. Mm. Happy?
Happier.
That's a good shot.
Where is that church? Portugal.
Yes.
First of all, I like this shot. It shows the scale of the building. It's very impressive. But I would bring up the whites a little bit. Why is this happening to me?
I think it's mainly, you know, churches and dramatic skies are easier to tell a story with. But there might be a more compelling story right in on the building. You know, that's if it was a portrait, that'd be an environmental one. We've got the people, we're seeing a bit of the city. But I think, for me anyway, the interest of the shot actually comes from the drama in the sky and the building, not so much the mishmash of people.
So you would have focused it more on the building and the sky and left the people out of it?
I think I would have, yeah.
Yeah, I was thinking the exact same thing. You took the words out of my mouth. This shot, the first thing I think is big parking lot filled with people. That's what they're conveying. And then a building in the background. And just compositionally find a way to make that building in the foreground. I think it might have been a stronger shot.
But there's interesting shots like that if you're going to a really, say, the Grand Canyon, and then you get the shot of all the tour buses and the lines and stuff.
That tells an interesting story.
Yeah. But I don't know how many people would recognize that, and I don't think it's busy enough to really tell that kind of a story.
Unrelated, but you've traveled around. You've been to more than 30 countries, I think.
I think so. Is this a competition? Because I know you guys have been to heaps.
No, you win this one. I was just going to ask, if there's a travel photographer out there who wants to put an amazing shot on their portfolio, what country would you send them to first?
Obviously, one of the ones I run tours to, obviously.
That's right. Matt runs tours.
Thank you very much. You know, it's a funny one. You can't go wrong in Cuba. And I don't have a tour to Cuba, but there's a reason why every photographer who goes there ends up putting out a photo book, because really you pass on every street, you'll pass 10 interesting faces and they're all happy to be, to have their photo taken. Yeah. Sorry, Americans, it's hard for you to go at the moment, but the texture's on the wall and it's such an imperialist way to look at it, but everything's kind of decaying to just the right amount to be beautiful to take photos of. And so if you can,
want to go to Cuba.
Yeah, we've been talking about it. It's just hard to get there.
Americans, there's ways to get there. You just got to take a cultural tour or whatever, be dodgy.
I'm dodgy. Look at me.
Yeah, that's why I looked at him when I said cultural tour.
We're clearly journalists. Journalists can get there.
but yeah, depends on what you want. Of the last places I went, Bhutan was amazing. Yeah. As a portrait photographer, not a single person in the whole country said no for a photo. Yeah.
Wow.
Like maybe 6 or 7 instead of saying no would be so excited they ran to their car and like brought me a cucumber or a melon to say thank you for it, or would invite me to their house to have drinks and stuff.
That's
and
so it's sweet.
Just that sounds really nice.
Yeah, it's kind of comfortable for tourists, but just not at all touristy, if you know what I mean. Like there's not people trying to sell to you. They just, again, I don't like to use the word, but really unspoiled in that sense of they're up to meet people. And when I was watching them, like, I'm taking a photo for 10 minutes. If someone came to Australia and was taking my photo for 10 minutes, I would, I'd get sick of it after 2, I'm sure. But they're just so patient.
You can check out Matt's tours at macranger.com, and you can see there's a workshops and events menu here where he has a ton of stuff. You are a busy fella.
Yeah.
I'm jealous of how much you get to travel. Siobhan, do you have any questions for any of us?
You bet I do.
Have you got your Christmas wrapping paper out already, Siobhan?
Oh, God, I still haven't moved it. Tony picked on me for it last week.
Oh, sorry. I didn't see that.
It was her friend's birthday or something.
I would love to tell you that I'm getting a jump start on Christmas, but that will never be true. Okay. It's really like a month after wrapping a child's birthday gift.
Siobhan's in the process of moving, so stuff's hectic for her now, and that's why.
That's a great excuse.
Stop
Thank
picking
you.
On a Matt.
She's always like that.
Matt, do you have any suggestions for shooting in humid rainforest climates for protecting gear?
I'm sorry to say I haven't really shot in those environments, so I'd be making it up. My tour partner at the moment is in the Amazon, and I'm sure, the normal things. I've shot in humid places, but not rainforest, so it's not just a no answer. I'll give you the little bit of advice I have. If you're staying in hotels and stuff, leave all your gear in the car, or if the bathroom has a window that's not, and you can close off the air conditioning, leave all your gear as close to room temperature overnight. Otherwise, as soon as you go outside, they just fog up and you can't use them for half an hour. And over time, that's when you'll get fungus. So when I was in Thailand and we were close to the jungle, we just lock everything in the van overnight. So when you came out, it was still 30 degrees or whatever all night, so 90 something. So you're not getting that buildup, but not really my forte. Sorry, have you guys been to the jungle?
No.
We've been in rainforest, but I don't know that I have any advice.
We haven't had
advice about
problems
it.
With fogging.
No, not really. And we had a couple of cameras wrecked because we got caught in a rainstorm when we were out on a hike. It was not in a rainforest. It was just a flash storm. Mm. And killed 2 5Ds, actually, like weather-sealed cameras.
Oh, yeah. That was a rough trip.
And I don't know. I will say I almost always keep just a couple of like plastic grocery bags crammed in my bag, just in case something terrible happens.
I know people use the hand warmers in the bathroom, too, if they have those available to warm up their camera before they go out.
Oh, yeah. I can't say fogging's ever been a big problem for me. It is like in the first few minutes.
For the rain, I always steal the shower caps from hotels.
So
if
that's
it comes,
a good
you can wrap
plan.
It over.
Yeah.
But I can't stand by this, but I've heard from people who got their camera saturated that they stuck it in like a bag of rice for a couple of days and it came good.
Really?
Yes. If you get in really quick so the moisture doesn't set in. I don't know if that's true. It could be a pizza picking story.
Pizza picking.
I will give you another tip. People will buy broken cameras for more than you would think. So something like, I think I sold my 5D Mark II broken completely saturated in water for like $850. So if you're pondering getting it repaired, get an estimate on the repair, but then factor in how much you could sell the broken one for and then buy another used copy. Because I think I sold it for $850, but I could buy a working used copy for $1,100. So therefore, any repair that cost me more than $300 just wouldn't be worth it.
Yeah.
Just in case it does get wrecked. Let's take a look at a couple more pictures. This is Crater Lake, apparently.
Beautiful. So much blue.
Yeah, it is really beautiful. A little bit of sensor dust there, just nitpicking. It happens to all of us, especially when you're traveling. Spot there too. But I think it's a beautifully framed shot. There's no particular focal point, but I think the color does it for me.
It's very serene.
Yeah. Matt's definitely pondering this.
There's something, for me, there's something just a little bit off balance.
Yeah, I felt that too, but I hate being that horizon guy. But
he's that horizon guy. Let
But I didn't notice it, so.
But it's hard to tell when it's all arcing like that, but it looked to me like the right side's a little high. But I just don't really love the dark brown soil on the right. Everything else is quite, you know, we've got the greens, blues, kind of the almost white soil down the bottom. Maybe even just coming down a bit closer to frame that out so you could just have the trees and have no idea if that was the case, but if that lighter soil continues.
What do you do about sensor dust, Matt?
Just shoot wide open for the rest of the trip.
Just try to blur it out.
No, I'm actually, I'm sure like you guys, for years I get questions about sensor cleaning and I've never cleaned my own sensors. I break everything already, so why would I want to stick my fingers in something? But I'm getting to the point now where I think I need to get a system to do it on the road because, that last trip I must have shot 10,000 frames, so of course everything came back dirty. What do you use?
I just have, when I travel, I just carry a little sensor pen. So it has like a brush on one side and then like a little pad on the other. Sensor Clear, I think it's called. And when I'm home, I have like a loop that lets you look at it to make sure you get it right.
Okay.
And it's kind of better than nothing. But at the same time, I still always end up with shots with sensor dust in it. And in photos, you can go in and retouch it, you know? So if you took 10,000 shots, you probably have like five that you're gonna do something with, and it's pretty easy to clean it up. But we shoot video, and when you take the video, it's not so easy to clean out sensor dust, and everybody complains because it's this fixed thing. You pan the camera, and this fixed spot stays there, so it really jumps out of your eye. I was just genuinely wondering. I wasn't, like, leading to my own answer. I'm like, maybe somebody's figured this out. I find it such a pain, though.
That's one thing, as rough as I am with my gear, that's one thing I'm really careful about, is changing them and making sure the lenses I put on are clean as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I often have my lenses uncapped in the bag just because I forget to put all the caps on. So before I put it on, I'll give them a blowout so you're not putting all the lenses, the dust that's collected in the back of the lens into
your
camera.
Oh, like the back element, you'll actually, that's a really good idea. Yeah, I do wonder how so much dust gets in there, especially when I haven't like changed the lens or anything. It's still filthy.
That looks like Luang Prabang in Laos.
I stayed on Prabang.
That strip. Yep.
That's, holy cow.
It's I know that hotel. I stayed, I think, in that hotel because there was this place that always had vintage cars out the front, and the Laotian monks wear that color of orange. I reckon kind of missed it.
You can't crop out the monks.
But they're kind of already on the edge of frame already.
Yeah, I was bothered by it being off level, but you're right. I do think the monks are key there, and maybe they could have even, they're already kind of an awkward, they're cropped funny and they're a little bit out of focus.
What a beautiful car.
So there's three cool things there. The vintage cars, the colonial buildings, or four, the monks, and then all of that, rainforesty, rich thing.
I think we got a pick on our hands.
You could shoot from the middle of the street and get them as they walk between the two cars. You know, because they're walking in front of trees. That could be a shot.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, and if you shot a little bit wider, you could have at least leveled it. And you would have had that opportunity to crop it and frame it.
In my experience in Southeast Asia with monks, you'll quickly work out if they're going to be patient and happy to have their photo taken or not.
Mm-hmm.
And you could actually ask them to go somewhere and pose for you and give a small donation at the end.
Oh. Monks are just like models for hire, then it sounds like.
Well, they spend their day begging for cash, so.
Yeah. I think this shot's really beautiful.
Gordon Lang, Chicago.
I will say I liked it way better in black and white. Well, I like the blue of the sky.
I tried it because there are so many lines, but the colors are really nice too.
Isn't Gordon Lang a camera reviewer?
I don't know.
The name's familiar.
I don't know. Maybe you do know.
Yeah.
I'm a little bugged by the amount of negative space down here, though. I suppose it's
look
pretty well
balanced. Look at all of the shadows of the people.
Wait, what are those shadows?
I started
popping it, but
oh, it's trees. Okay.
I think it's a cool shot.
Because these look like heads to me, but you're right. I think it is trees.
Must have been taken on just a fisheye lens. It's a super wide angle.
Yeah, that's
so
interesting.
Yeah, manual one. No data has come through. Yeah, I reckon that'd be really painstaking to get it framed up so well.
I think this is a beautiful shot. Though something about the sun looks weird to me.
Oh, well, it's overly saturated and the rest is desaturated.
Yeah, it's like a muddiness to the rest of the photo.
The sun might be fake, right?
No.
Fake or just really accentuated?
I think that they just oversaturated it.
But how is the sun not overexposed? Like, who's taking a picture of a sun in a landscape and the sun was not overexposed?
Oh, well, it would be incredibly hazy there. So
yeah,
that could be it.
Okay.
But I don't know, I'm never a huge fan. Oh, there's very rarely a shot that's like mostly desaturated then with like the red handbag that pops out that doesn't just look tacky to me. But that's not fully saturated. But yeah, maybe with a blue tint to the foreground. It makes it look more landscape instead of it's near a factory, the gray. Mist.
Yeah, that haze looked like it was pollution, right?
I've never been to Halong Bay, but it's not. It's kind of a nature reserve, so I think that works.
I like the shot a lot. I don't know why. It was just this was the one flaw that just jumped out at me. And maybe the sun is actually too sharp.
I like the layers of the mountains, all of the different colors, and
yeah. I feel like if there's this much haze, the sun itself would be just blurrier. I don't know. There's something about it that's bugging me, but I love the shot. If there was something done in post on that,
let's go there and figure out what's up with that stupid sun.
Okay.
I'm going in December. You want to come?
I do.
There you go.
Yeah.
When in December?
Like next month?
Yeah. Oh. Is that next month? No,
it's October
well,
now.
Wow. Okay.
Well, I'll probably come on.
But I'll be going to Ho Chi Minh probably around the 10th or 12th of December.
Do you have any spots available on your tour? Two of them?
That's not a tour.
Oh, no, you're just going?
Yeah. You just never...
You're just going for fun?
No,
I'll probably go and do some talks in a couple of cities. I haven't worked it out yet, but Ho Chi Minh's almost certainly one.
Will you turn it into a tour?
If I get
a three-man tour.
A three-man tour.
I've got a great local guide.
A three-man tour. That's an American joke about Gilligan's Island. You'll get there.
Surely they have Gilligan's Island. You don't know Gilligan's Island?
Yeah, it just came out on cable in Australia.
Yeah, they're about 40 years behind.
Uh-huh. I think they're going to like put it on every night after Bonanza and Seinfeld finish their run.
Oh, yeah. You guys are going to get pumped when you get color shows.
I know, right?
Yeah.
You should see my CRT. I've never seen that vantage point of Marina Bay Sands, actually.
Oh, maybe they're in a helicopter or something.
Nicely framed. What do you think? You can't cut out that building, but see the big tone change when you get to that second one and it doesn't have the lights of the city, it just becomes all that yellow. Do you like it or have it end with the building? It'd put it probably too close. Could you just recolor that road?
You definitely could, yeah.
Done.
Fix it.
I think it works perfectly in black and white. Siobhan, we'll go back to you. You have any questions for us?
I have lots.
Cuba.
Definitely Cuba, yeah.
Let's see. Matt, do you use offline backup as well as NAS backup?
Yes.
Good question. You have a NAS too?
Yeah, I've got a... not for everything, obviously. Like that last trip what did I come back with? A couple of terabytes worth of data, video and stills. So I've got NAS in studio, a 6 bay and a 4 bay, I think. And then I've got offsite as well. And then an offline, so what would you call it? Just a hard drive, but like a disaster proof one that's meant to, you can burn it and everything like that. And then I use cloud as well.
You complain about the bandwidth that you have there. Is that a problem for uploading stuff to your cloud?
Yeah. It's ridiculous. So when I'm home, I'll just upload the really key stuff. So I'm not backing up videos to the cloud, anything like that. So when I got back to like Bangkok and Seoul on the last trip, as soon as I got in the hotel, I'm uploading. But I don't have like a fancy cloud. I just put it to my Amazon AWS account.
Yeah.
It's really stable. I put it there to have a copy, not to really ever use it. So if Studio burnt down and I lost my NASs, then I could get it all back. I'd probably fly to America to download it because it'd take me a year in Sydney. But
yeah. Well, for those of you who don't know, it's important to get a backup of your files somewhere else because fire and theft. Mm-hmm. And if one of those strikes you, you will lose your computer and your backup. So Matt is using a cloud service, which basically a hard drive on the internet somewhere. Mm-hmm. And Amazon Web Services, AWS, will do this. They have a service called Glacier. I don't know if you use Glacier. It's just cheaper for long-term storage.
Yeah, but it's
storage.
So cheap anyway, to be honest. The one I'm using, it's like cents a month.
It adds up. It depends how much you have, because we have multiple terabytes of just photos. Mm. And for one, I've been trying to get this on a cloud service for the longest time, but it takes, like, I'll calculate it. It will take like 6 months for me to upload it. If it's uploading constantly.
Can you just drop them a hard drive and ask them to plug it in?
There are services that will just take a hard drive for
you. Okay.
Yeah, so that's kind of what we do, is I will just put stuff on a hard drive and then give it to someone else to take to their house and hide away somewhere.
Yeah.
Just in case stuff gets terrible.
One thing I used to do, and I only do it now when I'm doing like a book project, is when I'm getting close and I've got my key shots edited, then I'll put them on DVD as well. That's meant to be a bit more stable than hard drive. But it's
long-term storage can be a problem too. Like
one memory card could be 50 DVDs now, so it's not an everyday backup.
What about when you're traveling? Like, what happens if your room gets robbed or something? Do you do anything, or do you just take that risk?
I was gonna say, you cry.
I got lucky on this last trip. My D810's compact flash slot died. So then I was relying on SD on both of them, which meant I had 500 gig of compact flash cards I couldn't use. So I was making a backup to them, and then I kept them in different bags. But still, if my whole room got ransacked, then I'm out of luck.
We live on the edge, kind of like that.
Oh, yeah. I will say that I get oversized cards. I hope to have a card big enough to take all the stills and video that we'll use. That we'll shoot during the entire trip, so that I can keep it in the camera, and then when I get back to the room, I'll back it up to a computer, and I'll tend to leave the computer in the safe, and then we keep our cameras on us, and just hope that we don't get robbed at both places.
But Justin told me that the people at the hotel have the safe key.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
Because so then everyone forgets their PIN. But actually, yeah. So I'll normally travel with two hard drives, and at the moment, I'm actually using SSDs. Uh-huh. Sorry to interrupt. What is it?
Solid state drive.
It's a Samsung T1, but it's that big. It's an M-SATA drive, not the full one.
Yeah.
And it's crazy quick. So they're a terabyte each. So then I can do, like you said, keep one on the card. And then I didn't erase the cards until I had backed it up a second time. Yeah.
Have you ever had a SD or CF card fail?
Like once or twice. And it sucks, but...
Well, I bring this up because when we did our A7R2 review, we said it's a pro camera, but one of the big problems was it only had one SD card slot. And especially if you're doing a travel shoot where you might have spent thousands of bucks to get to a particular location, and maybe that's the day when you get your portfolio shot, and tomorrow's not going to be the same. What if that SD card fails? Your DA10, you can write it to two cards at once. The A7R2, one card at once. And it would be heartbreaking if that was the day when the SD card failed.
Yeah. But I think there's two things there. One, always format the card in the camera you're shooting and don't like put it from camera to camera. I think that was the only time I ever had problems. I'd like formatted it on the computer and then use it in the camera and it corrupted the database.
Oh, interesting.
But unless you break it, just stop writing to the card, hide it, with your life and take it home, and you'll be able to recover the photos from a card.
Yeah,
unless you actually smash it in half.
That happens sometimes. I have had a couple of cards that failed, and even photo recovery tools.
Yeah, right.
Like, I don't know what happened with them. They weren't physically damaged. But.
I never really thought about that. Often when I'm thinking about cameras, like, I will only use one card anyway. My D810, stupid maybe, but I just used the CF. So it was only when the CF went down, I'm like, oh, lucky I have a second one. Otherwise, that whole camera and my long lens option is gone.
Yeah.
Then I thought, and that's actually an advantage to having two cards, which normally is annoying. Mm.
Okay, we'll take a look at a couple more pictures. We
this
all know
this is a
topic
you kind of disagree on.
Ooh, fight on, did we?
A little bit. He prefers two, you prefer one. You feel it's more secure, he feels it's a risk.
I'm just happy that we disagree about something.
Well, you were trying to find something earlier.
Yeah. Yeah. We wanted to put together a video where we like debate something like mirrorless versus DSLR, primes versus...
If you have any suggestions, let us know, but don't make it too intellectual because I'm out of my depth.
Yeah, pitch in some suggestions, but we're both pretty moderate people. We're not loyal to any particular brand. We all just kind of do what we do and get the job done. And I think we're both a little bit concerned about losing files because most people, I think, don't even have a good backup of their stuff. And we've both been hurt before, so we compensate for that.
Siobhan, do you have any questions about life?
No, I do. Oh, about life. No.
Matt, got it all figured out.
No.
What is your source for finding professional models while you travel?
Great question.
We talked about this earlier, but
it depends how professional you want them. There's sites like, and everyone knows it, Model Mayhem, that a lot of people seem to use as a dating website more than anything else.
No, really?
Yeah.
Can we dig into this just a bit?
No, speak to any model, and I'm sure a percentage of the photographers that contact them are just creeps and want to hook up.
Siobhan did Model Mayhem.
Yeah.
I've found a lot of the best models I've ever worked with, I found there as well. It's like anything else. There's shitty photographers, there's shitty models, and there's great of both, and stylists and everything as well. So just see what works in that country you're visiting. So in the UK, they also use Purpleport. In France, they use something, I don't remember. But now I've got accounts for everything. Just upload a little gallery of stuff so you can start contacting people when you're there. And then you may, depends what you're shooting for as well, but there'll be, you know, Singapore fashion models Facebook group. And, you know, if you can get an invite to that, that's often an easy way to do it. But do it ahead of time. I was foolishly on the train today messaging potential models that are in Connecticut to see if we can do something afterwards. But yeah, so I think if you want to get someone professional, though, you either need to pay or have a really fantastic portfolio and concept that they're going to want to do. Otherwise, you know, why would they be reliable?
Right. Okay, yeah. We'll take a look at a couple of pictures. We'll come back to it in a bit, Siobhan. We all know this is...
Tony's available.
Being Cuba.
You have that fig leaf ready?
I got a fig leaf for him.
It's fall, though, so they're all like... Yellow,
I've got to find a big
just
one.
Just a maple leaf? Oh, my God. We're really going lowbrow here,
banana
guys.
Banana leaf.
A banana leaf?
They can be 10 foot. I read that on Nat Geo this morning.
Oh, that will do.
Yeah.
I gave this one a pick already. I just think it's beautiful. We have the converging lines over on the right. You have everything. It's so Cuba, right? They're even working it's on like, an old
what?
Car.
What are you looking at?
Beautiful colors.
It's a great picture. I like the story that it tells. It's kind of Rockwellian, only for Cuba.
Yeah, nice, nicely framed. I think it's lucky it's got that guy kind of looking at camera. Otherwise, yeah, no, it's nice.
Eye contact kind of brings
the hard light and the shadow is kind of hard. It looks like maybe they've done something on the shadow areas up front.
Yeah, maybe a little less on the processing, but I don't think it's too distracting. I think it's a great shot.
It's hard to go wrong in Cuba.
I don't know that you needed to be at 130-200. You probably could have dropped a ISO 100.
I love Cuban food.
I don't know if I've ever had it outside Cuba. And I don't really remember what it was.
New York has great Cuban food. A lot of plantains, beans. Their corn is really good. With lime
like
on
Peruvian?
It. It's spicy.
Is it like Peruvian food at all?
But no, I wouldn't compare the two. It's more like Puerto Rican food.
Never had that either. Shame on me.
All right, what's going on here?
This is almost, we screwed up the colors accidentally here, but this is almost a tale of two photos. Like here we have a very similar photo of a street. We have the converging lines in the distance. And then we have this shot. And I just feel like there's a good contrast here because here we have eye contact. We have the people in the frame. Mm-hmm. There's stuff that's like up front and is a clear focal point that does tell you something about the location. And here you get a sense for the location, but up front we just have kind of a generic looking bike.
Yeah.
And that's where my eyes went first.
I guess that's the thing when you're traveling, you're so often drawn to just what's different. So a Cuban coming to the Netherlands might find that to be a fascinating scene. Like look at how well maintained the buildings are and the roads are all flat and there's bikes everywhere. So yeah, like you were saying, having some kind of story that is going to make sense to someone who wasn't struck by maybe that day they had seen 50,000 bikes. You know, you walk through Amsterdam, there's just bikes everywhere. Yeah. So they wanted a bike shot, maybe.
Maybe so. I will say I see a couple of people on bikes over here. And so there might have been the opportunity, like, look how cute this lady is.
That lady's adorable.
With her little basket. I think the shot might have been to move over a little bit and wait for her to come past. Yeah. Like, crouch down ahead of time and just stay there. And she will just keep coming and just keep shooting. And at some point, she will be the focal point. Just a suggestion.
Nice.
Very monochromatic picture here. I can't say, I don't immediately get a sense for where
what
it
is.
This? Maybe a pollinator or something. Is that spot color? What is going on with that? Well, there's a bit of, everything's monochromatic except there's one thing in his hand, and I don't know what it is.
Can't see it at all.
I think it's a good shot.
The only thing would be if you could have the three characters not overlapping stuff.
Yeah.
That's what I was thinking. It almost looks like a two-headed person.
Maybe because... that's what he was shooting.
Oh my God.
That would be noteworthy.
This
that
must be the Philippines. It's an island.
A lot
They're
of
famous for that.
People? Yeah. Yeah.
They have 7,000 islands. At least 300 of them are duo-heados.
Duo-heados?
I have to go there. Duo-heados.
It's a technical term. Yeah.
A little medicine, a little medical training for Matt.
Yep.
So you saw that with patience. You could just get the shot, you know, find the location to hang out and just wait for the people to move around.
Or you could scream, move!
Shock!
Oh.
Oh.
Happy children. Where's this, Matt?
I don't know. They paint like that on the face in a lot of places. I didn't see any outfits like that in Bhutan. Maybe Nepal or somewhere like that. I'm totally guessing.
What's happening
here? I like the shot.
I
think there's the right amount of background in there. I think the camera settings are good.
180. Everything's a little bit out of focus.
Yeah, I think that they missed the focus just a little
probably
bit.
Probably kids were walking and...
Maybe, in fact, the shutter speed probably should have been faster. I said that.
Okay.
The camera the settings are good.
Yeah, 55 but 180.
ISO 400 and, you know, 1/320th probably would have been better. Compositionally, too.
But that's a bit nitpicky. It's still good.
Yeah, I think it works. I think here it doesn't detract too much. But maybe crouching down would have given you a little bit better composition.
Yeah, and the left, it's all the kids, right? Like, what's happening on the left and right, the boat. It's almost telling a transport story. You got a boat, a truck, and a bike, but it's kind of... The story's the kids.
Yeah, you're right. My eye checked out the other thing, but then they were not noteworthy enough to have such a prominent part of the picture.
It's two photos.
Oh, Atlantis. This is a resort somewhere in the Caribbean. Turks and Caicos? Turks and Caicos?
No, it's...
I think it's Bahamas.
It's the Bahamas,
oh, the Bahamas,
yeah.
All right.
I think it's a bit dark.
Have you been there?
I have been there.
Mm-hmm. I've not been there.
Is it nice?
Yeah, it's nice. But I never left the resort because I was just there for a wedding for a couple of days. So I'm not really a resort person.
But it was still nice.
It was nice. Is it the Matterhorn?
Yeah, I think that's the Matterhorn. I think this shot's fantastic. I like it a lot.
Look at that moon.
You got the moon in there, right?
And it's a realistic size.
Yeah. I actually appreciate that. I kind of want to throw a graduated filter in there because, I don't know, something about the bottom down here could be just more contrasty. I don't think we need to do too much to it. Maybe we just brighten it up a little bit.
Let's make it green.
Go for it. I don't know how you're going to make it green.
Skills.
But I love the train. I think it just provides just the right amount of interest in there, and you have that kind of windy road that leads your eye right over to the Matterhorn. I think the composition is fantastic. Mm. I'm giving that a pick. Well, you...
What happens with the picks at the end of the show?
Throw them out.
Yeah, they give... They can exchange them for points later.
Uh-huh.
No, Siobhan writes about them in a blog. She does a best of, so if we give likes and picks, then she... adds a link to them in the blog.
So every time you do that, she's like, oh, another one.
She's nodding. Yeah. Well, this is interesting. Have you ever been to a carnival?
We have them in Australia. Maybe not quite the same. I'm sure the hot dogs aren't as big in Australia.
Nothing's as big in Australia.
Just the bugs.
The bugs. The spiders.
And the snakes.
Oh, all the wrong things are big in Australia.
Well, this hardly feels like a travel photo to me. This feels like a traveling carnival.
Yeah.
But I think it's a cool shot.
Sorry.
A nice long exposure.
Yeah, I like it. Ooh.
Valdemosa.
I just want a little lady in this picture.
Yeah, it just needs a focal point, right? I think it's a beautiful scene. Just needs one of the things.
A little old lady. Or a cat.
Yeah, even a cat would be good. Even
with an eye infection. Is this
Iceland? What?
What?
That was weird.
Welcome to Tony's life.
I love the mood of the shot, the nice soft muted colors.
Yeah.
I think it conveys like wet and cool. It feels that way to me.
How would it look as a mono?
Oh. I like how you're thinking.
Meh.
You failed.
Maybe like
us.
A blue filter or something.
Make it more blue?
No, as a black and white, I meant a blue filter, black and white.
Oh, hold on. I think I can.
I never do it that way.
I can. I think I can do it with this. There we go.
No, not what I meant, but that's okay.
That's all right. We don't have to always agree.
And well, you and I don't have that problem, it seems.
So what's up? You can take the wheel right here. See this?
Yeah, show us how it's done, Matt.
Show us that blue filter.
Well, over in the presets, you can. There's a blue, black and white starting point here. I am struggling to see this far. I'm such an old man.
We've said that about you.
You have?
Mm-hmm. Well, not when you're not around. Nice That'd be person. Rude.
You are not a very nice person.
No, that's not my claim. That's not my claim to fame.
Well, it's not that great after all.
Oh, I see what you mean.
That was a lot of buildup.
Was it really?
No.
I could have dragged it out.
I do think
the waterfall
looks great with that blue filter on. I think you take one exposure with the blue filter on and then blend it with something that shows off the grass in the background a little
How
bit better.
How do you do that?
The moss.
Yeah, the blue filter, just this? No. Oh, it's this. It's this way. It's the other way. Counterintuitive. Cool. Waterfalls. I like waterfalls, guys.
I like TLC.
I don't go chasing them.
Mm-hmm.
All right. This makes me lonely.
It needs a focal point, right?
The end. Oh, I was just there on Saturday.
Look at these feet.
It's funny that, huh? And they're all like Martin straight, kind of 45 degree angles.
Look at all of these ghosts.
What? This is something different than just a long exposure, right?
No, if just at the right amount of time,
yeah.
The feet are planted the longest, so they'll be the last thing to disappear.
Yeah, I guess so. I was just amazed that those people, I guess smartphones make people hold precisely still for a really long time. Those people are so sharp.
What is
it? It's hard to get people to stay still.
Second and a half.
So the long exposure helps to convey motion and busyness. And yeah, so it works really well.
Then that first person really anchors it, right? I think if they weren't there, if you didn't have a sharp person in the front, it'd be kind of a wishy-washy if it was just the legs making the shot.
Yeah, I agree.
Thanks.
Good shot.
I have a gift for you, Tony.
You know some stuff about stuff, Matt Granger.
Oh, Vegemite, this is my favorite.
I've noticed actually... you finished your beer, so you should totally finish the tube of Vegemite.
Oh my God.
Next.
This is actually in a toothpaste format.
Uh-huh. What do you use to brush your teeth?
Just minty
mayonnaise.
Yeah.
No, you should definitely eat it.
This is so much culture. Vegemite. I just...
That's the smallest tube you can buy.
What?
Oh, God. I opened it.
Yeah, no, now you need to just squeeze it in. No, go for it. That's you, Chelsea. You're the one who broke the seal. You eat that. For those who don't know, Vegemite is...
Oh, come on, more than that. What are you doing? Yeah, I'll help you.
It's like salted ass.
No.
Salted ass?
Yeah, it's what's their tagline.
This is a travel Vegemite, show. You should be, respecting my culture. That was nothing.
It tastes like plant food. No, stop it. Oh, dear God.
Oh, my God, Matt.
Don't do it.
That's a minimum. And this is warm, too, so it's easy to eat.
Ew. It's warm, warm from your body.
It was my body.
You just took a mess. Ew.
They did this to James Bond in one movie.
Did he talk?
Yeah, he gave up the secrets in that one.
It's really good.
It tastes like a medical condition.
Plus burnt hair. Jeez. So if you're thinking of your next travel destination, Australia, culinary highlight.
Thanks, Matt.
Yeah, so thank you so much for bringing me up to your place and inviting
Thanks
me
for
on
waiting
the show.
Until I finish my drink.
Yeah.
God, that's literally...
That's like if a Canadian came and gave you maple syrup and you gave them a hard time.
No,
that'd be game over.
Have you tried maple syrup?
No, but this is as important to us, you jerks.
If this is important to you, you need to reprioritize.
Okay. That's the worst thing that
this
I've had in my mouth.
And proudly made in Australia.
Justin,
proudly,
can you call my embassy?
Proudly made in Australia. Call your embassy.
That you have just offended at least 6 Australian viewers.
Oh, at least 6. I
don't know how I'm going to move past this.
This ended the show.
All right,
show.
I'll ask Matt some questions if that.
Yeah, please jump in, Siobhan.
Sensory overload.
Man.
Oh, I do not envy you right now.
Huh? Oh, you keep going.
I thought you'd have crackers. Yes.
I thought you'd have crackers.
When did you get started as a photographer, and what did you enjoy shooting most when you started?
Thanks for the question. You get questions like this, and I feel so repetitive to anyone who's watched a lot of stuff because you feel like you've answered it all the time.
Just give a different answer every time.
Okay. 3 weeks ago. It was a boring day. I had nothing to do. No. Broad strokes. I got my first camera when I was like 5 or something. I don't know. I don't remember. My grandmother seemed to upgrade her camera every... It felt like every week. I'm sure it was every 6 months. So I got all of her old cartridge cameras, and she was prolific. Like, she literally shot a roll of film every day.
Wow.
She'd drive into town, drop it off at the chemist to get it remade. Crackers.
Oh my God.
And yeah, so my dad's mum and my dad were both into photography. So dad would drag us around the camera shops whenever we'd travel internationally. Then I just kept shooting all the way through. I don't think I shot a decent photo for 15 years, probably. I studied in high school and started actually thinking about what I was shooting. Started taking paid jobs maybe, I don't know, my mid-20s. And then moved to doing nothing but photography and then YouTube and stuff maybe 5 ago. How about you, Chelsea?
I just wing it.
You wang it.
I wanged it. I still don't know. Yeah. No,
they didn't ask when did you get good or when did you know what you're doing. Just how'd you start? How'd you get interested?
I've always liked the arts. I've always tried everything. Painting, music, drawing, whatever I could try. Vegemite. And then I took a photography class in high school, and that's when I started to realize it was more than just pointing at things and pressing a button. I actually had no idea there were even settings before that point.
Did someone leave a mean comment about my heritage? Why are you laughing? No?
Oh, I was just laughing because I noticed Tony had to run grab another beer.
I had to do something. I was trying to just man up and power through it.
Which oddly has a lot of yeast in it, which is what this is.
This is made from the byproduct of making that.
This helps fight fatigue.
Oh, so it's like that movie Twins, and this is Arnold Schwarzenegger and that's Danny DeVito.
But who would you rather have dinner with?
Timely reference, Tony.
Yeah, way up to date. being strategic and thinking of this as a cross promotion. If you're going to watch any of my videos, watch the one where I tried to eat like a kilo of this in one sitting.
What happened to you?
How
were you here?
It was such a bad idea. Can we chalk it up to I was young and naive and it was 3 months ago?
Just a babe.
We tried it for the first time in Scotland with our breakfast.
Were you trying to get out of haggis?
I don't know. There was a lot of beans and sausage. We were like, what's up? What's this stuff? And we took a big bite and we sat there for a healthy 5 minutes just...
Oh, deep burn.
Yeah.
Yeah, fortunately it was Scotland, so I had a beer with my breakfast anyway.
Yeah.
Something to wash it down.
Siobhan, do you have any other questions?
I have lots.
You go, girl.
Matt.
Enough.
It's already gone. Let me have the last... Yes.
Matt, have you ever had a low point in your professional career that almost made you quit?
It's probably right now.
Right now.
What was your reason?
I think probably, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but probably the same as these guys. What we do is not your typical photographer job. So, you know, the percentage of time I'm out there trying to hustle to get clients or meeting those kind of deadlines is a lot less than your average working photographer. So I don't think I face the same kind of pressures they do. Not really, but I built it so long doing paid work on the side and, you know, 9-to-5 work and then doing another 40 hours a week of photography and stuff on the side that by the time I stepped across, I already, you know, was at a point where it was sustainable.
Yeah.
So I think maybe that's tied to a question you often get is once it becomes a job, is it not fun anymore?
It's still fun.
Yeah, for me, it's still fun. I can, but again, I think that's because we do something different. Like every right. week you can think about, hey, let's do a tutorial on this, something that I actually want to do. Or yeah. I'm saying, you know, I think I want to go to Northern India and see this festival and that'll be brilliant and I can tie in work somehow. That's not a privilege most people have.
Well, that so having been lucky. Said, I think most people don't realize you can make up your own job.
Yeah.
It's not, you just have to think of what you'd like to do.
I think on it, that's the hardest part. And there's yeah. people close to me all the time who ask stuff like this. I'm like, just what do you want to do? And most people, I think, don't, either they know it and they don't want to vocalize it because it sounds too crazy, or they really don't know. And it's, you know, how much do you hate your current job versus how much do you fear taking the leap? And when yeah. you get that balance right, you'll go for it.
Yeah, I think you just have to put yourself out there and try a bunch of different things and not be too fearful.
If you could summarize that, that'd be a perfect Hallmark card.
Thank you. Our friend Irky was doing a bunch of different types of photography.
Dog guy, right?
Yes. He started taking pictures of dogs, and now he's being flown to different countries mm-hmm. to take dog pictures. It's like you have to put yourself out there, you have to take some risks, and you have to work hard. Mm.
That's actually what we're talking about in the car, too. You just have to find your little niche.
Yeah.
You know, there's such a huge market out there now. If you do get to an international level, you only need a tenth of a percent of people to love what you're doing, and you can be huge.
Yeah, and it's the best time, I think, in our history because we can now go direct to people and you really can make up your own job. You know, 20 years ago when I was getting out of college, you pretty much just had to go work for a corporation and that could probably be the next 40 years of your life. But now we can make up a job where you travel around and take pictures and just have to scramble and find people.
The flip side of that is in a couple of years, our job won't exist. So we need to keep finding what's our job going to be for the next few years.
We've already had to reinvent ourselves a few times.
What was your former name?
Well, not our former name, but we had a stock site called Northrop.org, and it made a good amount of money for us just putting up as many pictures as we could of different mm-hmm. things. People would search it. They show up there. We'd get money for it. Then Google changed their algorithm, and that whole part of our business was dead almost mm. overnight.
And then we were doing MicroStock, which was yeah. huge for a while, and then there got to be a lot of MicroStock sites, and they competed on price, and pretty soon you weren't making any money from that at all. And of course I was writing books and computer books specifically, and the publishing industry has really declined. And of course we still do that, but yeah, we just have to constantly keep changing paths.
Reinventing, yeah.
So you're right. There's going to be something after all of this, and I don't know exactly what that will be.
Probably more Vegemite.
I don't know that Vegemite has a big part of my future.
I think that's going to be gone soon.
Since 1923, still here.
It's still here.
Burning the back of your palate, right?
Yeah. Oh, I can still taste it.
Yeah. Finds okay. any wounds you have in your mouth.
Take a look at a couple of pictures. We'll go back to questions. This is definitely in Thailand.
Mm-hmm. This is my favorite part of Thailand.
Yeah.
That's the Mekong Delta, isn't it? So clean.
Yeah it is.
So the first thing that bumped me was the composition of it. There's just more space down here than there is up here.
Okay.
I'd tilt back a little.
You tilt it.
Unless it was maybe a longer exposure and you got some interesting, you know, smokiness through the water or something like that.
Yeah, maybe if there was some sort of focal point down there. Also, in general, in night photography, I'd rather be out a little couple hours earlier when there's some texture in the sky still, get it nice and blue.
Yeah.
That's the hardest point and it depends, you'll get lucky or unlucky with the buildings. If you can find that 10 minutes when the sky is getting dark enough and still has color and the lights have come on the structure here, the bridge, that they are kind of at the same level, that's magic. But often you'll find the lights come on too early or too late, or the tour bus is leaving before you get to that point.
Yeah,
and you're right, it is 10 minutes and sometimes you just have to find the spot. We'll go out during the day and we just call it location scouting. And we'll just be looking for good restaurants and nice locations. And then we'll make a mental note, like come here at dusk or 30 minutes before dusk and just wait for those 10 minutes because you don't know when they're going to be. I went through and kind of pared stuff down because I had a bunch of pictures left. So we have a few more pictures to go through.
Okay. I like the colors.
Yeah, and this one is...
I never noticed Buddha... is that going to be offensive to people? I never noticed the Buddha's profile having a big nose like that.
Me either.
And is that the back of a Buddha's head on the left, or is that a stupa, do you think? It looks like ears pointing out the sides.
Oh, I thought this was a building.
Stupa. Yeah, oh, good question. Yeah, I just assumed it was a steeple. It is kind of hard to tell. I like...
Realistic moon?
The silhouette here, but it feels a little, it just feels left heavy. Mm. And I look at the two elements and I look for some sort of relationship between them and I don't see it. Like, I don't know how they know each other.
We met on Grindr.
On Grindr.
I know which is which. Anyway, moving on.
Hey, Grindr is for gentlemen and...
Grindr.
And Tinder's for...
Tinder is for, yeah, everybody.
Ladies like me. Okay, this,
Clang.
Clang. This is,
somebody got a new helmet.
And it is badass. I think there's a little bit of oversaturation. See this happening?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I'll agree with that. The reason I set this one aside is that they added a focal point to a picture that might have needed a focal point. And so many of the pictures we looked at, we've been like, it just needs one other thing. So they did add that one other thing. But looking at it up close, I can see the background's a little bit out of focus and maybe the helmet. I don't know. It does tell a part of the story. You can see on a motorcycle trip through the Rockies.
If they want to tell that story, I reckon, if they were down lower and to their left, so they got rid of this, got rid of this, that's not framing anything, and then leave their motorbike in the pool of light there. So it stands out as well. So then, you know, hopefully that's a winding road and then you've got your bike, your helmet, and then just mountains and stuff.
If you had the road, you'd have a leading line as well.
Great suggestions.
Although I made all of it up and I don't know, there may have been no road there.
Yeah, we never know what's going on.
We have that same feeling. We're like, we can tell you kind of what would have worked, but I don't even know really if it would have worked. This is nice light.
Yeah, I always feel like the Grand Canyon is a really difficult place to photograph because it's actually very flat. You know, it's because it's all going down. So either you're in it and you're looking up, or you're on top of it and you're looking down, in which case there's no mountains breaking the horizon. The horizon's flat. So the best you can hope for is some detail in the light. And I don't know. It's such a beautiful place to be, but I feel like it's such a difficult place to photograph. Have you been there, Matt?
No. But that's something I find all the time. Like, especially when I'm doing vlogs even, it's just like, you can't give someone that. Like, you don't smell the market, you don't hear the music, you don't all of that stuff. It's really hard to convey that sense of awe you get at something unless you can really show crazy scale. So, like you said, maybe being down in it, shooting up really wide, but I've never even been there.
I've been there a couple of times, and it's not like I have any Grand Canyon pictures in my portfolio. I couldn't get the pictures to just even scratch the surface to capture what is there. And I think this is a very good Grand Canyon picture. They have beautiful texture in the sky. They have light, and they're showing it. But I feel like the Grand Canyon can be a very difficult place to capture. But they got a good picture of it.
You just put a nude model in the foreground. Done.
Yeah, that certainly helps. Just bring a nude person around with you everywhere.
A nude person. I like it. Almost sounds like the politically correct term.
An unclothed individual.
This seems like. I guess they could be visiting New England or something. Well, I think it's HDR'd some, so that might reduce the contrast a little much.
Yeah. Where am I? I want it.
Much better.
There's something flat about it. Why do I keep accidentally pressing things?
Close? Yeah, I think HDR will make everything seem kind of flat.
Which is the opposite of what it should be doing, right? You think it's just because so much of it is that milky water and there's not much there?
Yeah, possibly.
Yeah.
I think I would have to go in and kind of dodge and burn some contrast in.
Yeah, maybe so.
I mean, that looks like crap, but just because these seem like they should be white.
I really like the picture. I think it works really well. I'd probably crop in from the right a little bit and move that sun a little closer to the right edge, because it feels a little left heavy to me still. Mm-hmm. But I think it works, and maybe the processing was just a bit much. Maybe the saturation is a bit much, but I think overall they've done a good job with it.
I'm no expert on that kind of thing, but I'll often try to do like shutter speed duration bracketing. So you've got the really milky water. If it's kind of peaceful, you might get to see through the water altogether, and then just a little bit of movement. So you've got different amounts of texture to play with.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a great idea. I can't believe you're going back for that Vegemite.
It's hoppy. It's malty. It's good.
Wow.
I'm just preparing for dinner. This is my lunch. So like clean me out, ready for that
dinner.
Seafood challenge.
It's quarter after four.
We're going
out for
dinner
for an eating competition tonight.
I've backed down several times.
I don't accept that.
Oh, yeah. Are you taking him pizza picking?
Do you want to go pizza picking?
Here. It's like this. I know what you're talking about, but it's just, it's the dumbest thing ever. Who's ever believed that?
You seem gullible. Not that gullible?
Oh, we could take you apple picking instead.
Oh.
They do grow on trees.
Yeah, the apples grow on trees.
My dad's a farmer. I'm fourth generation orchardist.
Oh.
Yeah.
So you're not going to get...
Not a pizza orchard, though.
You're not going to get excited about...
So I guess you know apples are technically legumes.
I would get really psyched about a falafel orchard.
That's pretty sweet, right?
No, we're going to Bar Americaine, and we're going to have seafood.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, Southern style food as well, if you're up for it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Have you been Bon Bon?
Bon Bon.
What?
Bon Bon, have
oh,
you been
God.
To...
Oh, God, no.
Wake up.
Don't, no. That is not going to catch
Can't
on.
Hear you.
No, that looks I haven't like been a, there, yes, please.
But you've been to Mohegan Sun, right?
That's is it just me that can't hear?
Oh, God, yes.
Yeah, of course.
Maybe, oh, your mic may have turned off.
Mohegan Sun is pimping. So here we have a building, maybe it's in New York. I like it though, I kind of wish I could see the sky a
Me
little
too.
Bit. The crop at the top feels a little weird. But overall I think it's a good
job,
choice for black and white. Here we have
Do it.
A beautiful sky, and the sky totally makes this picture for me.
Where
the sky
is this? Is this?
Weren't so dramatic.
Is this like South America? No.
Almost looks like it could be Cradle Bay. Oh, but if that's not the temple in no, there's nowhere near the water. I was thinking, you know, that four-sided temple that they used to do sacrifices at in Mexico, but that's nowhere near
that
kind of
landscape.
That sounds
like my kind of place.
Yeah, I actually don't know where this is, but I think it's
Let's
beautiful.
Go there.
I do get a South America vibe too. Yeah, maybe they could tell us, Siobhan, if you see somebody.
Is this Rio?
Doesn't look dense enough.
Oh, Rio's much bigger, right?
I haven't been there either, but
I agree that it has a South American feel for some reason, but I'm not
It's
sure.
Cape Town, South Africa.
Oh, okay. So we've been talking about going to Cape Town. Looks just gorgeous,
oh.
right?
Oh. Have you been to Cape Town?
My parents go every year. It's meant
I'd
to be nice.
I'd love to go there.
Oh. Have you been to anywhere in Africa?
No. Namibia will be my first next April, May.
Wow. You have such a full schedule.
Oh, Matt.
That's for
really
a tour. Plug, plug, plug.
You really impress us, Matt.
Speaking of Africa, here's a traditional African windmill.
Mm-hmm. Mm. The old Van Gogh.
I wish that the windmill were brighter, but then it blows up the sky.
Maybe yeah, I think working between. With the raw file would make it easier. But yeah, the picture's just generally underexposed, but... I like the kind of stark composition of it and the way it's against the bright sky.
Me too. Let's keep rolling, because you know what?
I filtered them down. So I weeded through just the thumbnails
low
that
five,
caught my
just
eye.
A low five. That's a low 20.
Having a good thumbnail, that's important in modern photography, right? As silly as that seems, you have to think about how your picture looks when it's this big, because you have to lure people into actually clicking it. You can have a beautiful picture blown up to 40 by 60, but if on the web, nobody's going to see that if it's all like very detail-oriented and cluttered.
Mm-hmm. I never really thought of it, to be honest, but I think it is worth thinking about when you're shooting how it's going to be used. Because, like you say, if it's going to rely on having heaps of detail and being able to make out the interplay of elements, that's not going to work on Instagram.
Right.
You know.
Right.
So, Siobhan, hit us with any remaining questions you have.
Yeah.
And then we'll get out of here and go eat some seafood. Laughs.
I have a lot. I'll just give you some.
Give us the best stuff.
Interesting ones. All right. Here's a question of Photo Plus. Disregarding the price of producing the Medicon 135mm f1.4, what do you think would be a reasonable price? How cheap would it need to be to win you guys over?
I think under $1,000. Do you have any interest in the Medicon 135 f1.4?
I like manual focus lenses, but I've never used one of their lenses to know.
Oh, you didn't stop by. I can see that they're only producing 100 of them.
What?
And I know, strange, right? And you have to pre-order it. So you put $500 down and then $2,500 when they're ready to ship it. You tell them what mount they want, what mount you want. And it weighs at least 4 pounds. So it's got a lot of glass in there. And from the shots we took, it looked sharp. So I don't think it's unreasonable to ask $3,000 for it, given the limited production run. And you'll have a lens that will give you a unique look, because nobody else is going to be getting 135 f1.4. They just won't. So if you work at that kind of focal length, it'll be unique. But for me, to lay down $3,000 for that, I don't have enough money for that. If I didn't care about $3,000, maybe I would.
It's not as fast, but I mean, Zeiss have for Sony a 135-1.8, which is autofocus and brilliantly sharp. So it's going to have to be cheaper than that, right?
Yeah, I totally agree. You're right that there is a good selection of fast 135s that are just a little bit less fast, but they have autofocus, and you so desperately need that autofocus.
And let's I'd see really what the T-stop is. Like, did you test it? How?
I actually could, because I have sample shots with it, mm-hmm. so I could see what the metering was like.
Okay.
But yeah, on my 50 Metacon, the T-stop is terrible. It's f0.95, and then the T-stop is like f1.4 mm-hmm. or T1.4 or something like that. I don't remember exactly, but it's not what you would think. What are your thoughts, Chelsea? What would you pay for that big Metacon?
I think under $1,000 seems reasonable.
You're going to factor in a monopod as well, right? Does it have a tripod collar?
I don't remember.
I don't remember either. What else you got, Siobhan?
Okay. Have you guys had anyone ever steal gear or try to steal gear while traveling? If so, where?
I already have a bunch of their stuff in my bag.
Yeah, he's been stealing from us all night.
You cannot trust Australians.
I haven't. I don't think I have.
No, I've never had any problem with it.
No, I think I've had stuff go missing from a hotel room or something like that, but not gear. I've only got kind of swindled once from memory. Like, that was for cash, not for gear.
Mm. How'd you get swindled? Was it a con?
Well, I don't even know if it was, but I think it must have been. It was someone with a sob story wanting some cash and yada, 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 help me out and I'll return the money, and never heard from him. But there was just, when I think back and I was like, it was too perfect a story. It was the usual one that I lost my passport and the embassy's closed today and yada, yada, yada. But then when I thought back, he's like, and he also said it was his birthday. That's too much. Like, because if that was real, I don't feel burnt. You know, if that was all true, $20, I did him a nice favor and he lost my email, that's fine. But, you know, it just seems a bit much to believe.
Yeah,
you got scammed. I love those scams, though. I always find them fascinating. When you travel, people know you're a tourist and they will give you that scam. And you're like,
Did you ever get the ring one in Paris? They come up to you with a ring and they say, oh, is this your ring? It's a gold ring.
Oh, whilst they're doing that, they're stealing your purse.
No. And then you say no. And they say, oh, well, I want you to have it. And I said, no, I don't want it. You have it. I can't do anything with it. You take it. And they said, no, just take it. Just take it. Come on. And they just put it in your hand. And then they go, oh, can I have a dollar for a soda? And I was like, take your ring back. Probably 20 minutes later, oh, is this your ring? Somebody else. So there's like this whole ring. There's a lot of little
scams. I noticed you're not wearing any rings.
We don't wear wedding rings.
Yeah. That was what I was thinking. Neither am I.
You don't wear yours either. Mm-hmm. Ooh, we're a little. Woo-hoo. We're a little.
Next question, please.
In America, though, the scam is always.
Oh, nice kitty.
I need gas money. You get that one a lot. And then there's some sob story associated with the gas money. But what else you got, Siobhan?
It's a big cat.
Yes, it is. That is Franklin D. Katzevelt.
Oh my God. What are some of your other cat names, Siobhan? Because you've had some good ones. Mr.
My
President?
Cat that ran away was John Cougar Mellencat. His previous name was Mr. President.
You renamed Mr. President. Well, it was worth it.
John Cougar Mellencat. I preferred Mr. President, but the rest of my household called him John Cougar Mellencat, uh-huh. So he was very
confused.
That's
a mouthful.
For a while.
So you had to run around the street calling that out.
Yeah. No, it's just Johnny. Johnny and Frank. Anyway, do you guys have any specific spots in Sicily for landscapes that you would recommend photographing?
I've never been to Sicily.
Me either.
Sadly, haven't been to Italy or Spain. No. Wow.
What else you got?
But I want to check out that island where the mafia came from.
Where's that?
Sicily,
an
pretty
island
much.
In Sicily. Yeah. An area of Sicily, yeah.
I want to go to that.
Next. Are you guys dressing up for Halloween?
Oh, I keep debating this. I wanted to be...
Patrick Swayze from Roadhouse.
Right, one of my favorite heroes. Because I've been Burt Reynolds from Smokey and the Bandit before. But Patrick Swayze from Roadhouse, he had a mullet. But other than that, he just wore like... pretty much no shirt or a black shirt, and I'm not going no-shirted on Halloween.
Sold. How about you?
I think I'm going to dress my cat up. Halloween's not a thing outside of America. Do you guys realize that?
No, yes, it is.
Make holidays. It's nothing.
Because we love fun.
You must be looking forward to Thanksgiving, right?
So you hate the Harry Potter as like an alchemist, but then dressing up was like...
No, we love Harry Potter. We have a whole amusement park for him. But also in Sweden, they started doing Halloween.
Really?
And in the UK and in Japan, they've started doing Halloween. So it's spreading. We're spreading our holiday cheer.
So those who don't know, on Halloween, kids and sometimes adults dress up.
Everybody knows, right?
And then they go door to door and people give them candy. So there's dressing up silly and getting candy. It's
awesome. Sometimes you get drugs.
Oh, yeah, drugs are razor blades, which is nice. Nice little surprise. Those are mostly myths, but... And then if you're an adult, you pretty much, like, dress up goofy and drink crazy. And for women, it's a great excuse to dress slutty.
I was going to say, in Australia, that's the only point, is going out on the weekend and, like, naughtiness and that kind of nonsense.
Chelsea's going to be...
How has that devolved into Patrick Swayze, for God's sake?
Well, most people don't dress up as Patrick Swayze, but that's just my own personal role
model. If you don't want to go topless, you could just tie a knot in the front of a shirt or something.
Like, if I don't...
Camp Patrick Swayze, no?
It's like you haven't seen Roadhouse.
I have. I remember a scene where like a guy had a knife on his boot and they
pain
broke
don't
it
hurt.
Off.
Yeah, pain
That's
don't hurt.
Pain don't hurt.
He puts his own stitches in. How could it not be your hero?
Pain don't hurt.
And he gave away his Mercedes at the start, I think.
Yeah,
because he doesn't.
Who gives a shit when you're that guy, right?
He was the very best bouncer in the world.
Don't get him started. We're going to have to watch
He was famous. The whole bouncing community.
So he was like really talented, yeah.
Yeah, he was really talented.
He killed a man with a throat punch. You know, he swore he would never do that again, but he had to.
Siobhan made a great Frank Zappa one year. And Tammy Faye Baker. No, she dresses up.
I think I'm going to.
No, I don't anymore. I did when I was a crazy single person.
Oh, I still plan on dressing up. I wanted to be sexy Jared Polin. You know
what
how, like,
would that be?
Well, you know how like every costume is like
just regular
that,
Jared Polin,
but sexy.
Hey,
you know, it's like a nurse but sexy, or like a female fire person but sexy, firefighter but sexy. I'd be Jared Polin, but then I'd have like an I shoot raw bikini and the frow.
You would need a lot of hairspray to get the big tease going on.
That's true.
Seems like a lot of effort. Why not just be a naughty nurse?
Yeah, probably. That's good.
Oh, actually, did Mr. Roadhouse have a sidekick?
Mr. Roadhouse? You're
informal. Oh, well,
no, he traveled alone.
Just go
How
one
dare you?
Step out, and you can be the chick from Dirty Dancing.
Oh, and dive.
Because Roadhouse would pick her above his head with one hand.
Yes.
No problem.
This is true.
Just watch out for that throat
Mr.
punch.
Roadhouse to you with throat punch.
Monsieur.
Mr. Roadhouse. What are you being for Halloween, Justin? Justin doesn't seem like a dress-up kind of guy.
Yeah, I have not put any thought into it, really. So disappointing.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'll be teaching.
You'll be teaching?
It's the 31st, right?
Yeah.
So it's a Saturday this year.
You should dress up as Tony.
Totally. Actually, that would be I'm doing a photography workshop, so totally. Yeah, can I borrow your NASA shirt and stretch at the t-shirt?
Yeah.
I didn't realize New York, there's like everything on next weekend. Halloween, marathon. Some football or sporting event that New York is in.
Wow.
Yeah. You guys should know, right?
I didn't. I'm out of the loop, but it sounds like a fun weekend.
No, but I'm working. So I chose a bad
But yeah,
weekend.
You should dress up as Tony. That'd be funny.
Sexy, I don't know that I'm distinctive enough.
Gray sexy hair, Tony. That gray hair, come on.
Yeah, but the people would be like, who are you, like Lauren Malvo? Are you the dog
whisperer
guy?
I don't know who either of those people are.
They're just who people think I look like. What else you got, Siobhan? Anything?
Except for an awkward feeling.
I mean, those were all the ones I chose for you, but I've got many more.
We can wrap it up.
Yeah, pick one random question and then we'll wrap it up.
Because I'm hungry.
Make fun of Tony, your terrible choices.
Tony, have you ever photographed a rocket launch or toured the Kennedy Space Center?
Oh, no, but we got invited.
Yeah, we planned to go shoot a rocket launch and then rocket launches get delayed all the time. So we got clearance from NASA
inconsiderate
to go there and photograph it, but then, you know, like a cloud came or something and they had to postpone the shoot.
There's ever been a moment to drop the don't you know who I am line, that's it.
Don't you know who I am?
Look at my shirt!
I'm Matt Granger's friend! Someone was convinced.
I self-bleeped that.
On vacation, a guy was like, you work for NASA? And Tony was like, no. And he was like, I don't believe you.
Undercover.
Yeah, he thought it was some sort of conspiracy. Like, I didn't want to admit that I was working at NASA, but I was wearing a shirt that said NASA in big letters.
Show me your ID.
Yeah, Tony was like, really?
No, I'm undercover, man.
I got the shirt at the Gap. You can look at the tag.
No, I'm not photographed the launch. I have.
That's hungry.
I've toured most of the big space centers, Houston and Florida,
that's
and
cute.
Air and Space Museum and all that. But I need to get back to NASA and reschedule.
Cool.
Okay. Sorry, that was a bummer of an answer. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll be back in just a couple of days on Thursday. We're reviewing spooky, scary photos.
Spooky, scary.
Join Patrick and Jared.
Thanks for coming out, Matt. Check out Matt's channel.
Thanks.
He makes awesome YouTube videos, and he's got a whole website at mattgranger.com where you can sign up for his workshops and events, and you can get a book filled with respectful nude photos.
Nah, they're somewhat.
Nice way to go out.
Awkward silence.
I reckon I could flip this table.
Thanks for making everything work today, Justin. Thank you, Siobhan, out in Philly, for screening all the questions. And we'll see you in just a couple of days. Bye, guys.
Thanks, guys.
Bye. Bye, Siobhan. Thank you. Bye, Justin. Thank
you. Vegemite.
Vegemite tingy.
That is all.